वेरी गुड डे टू माय स्टूडेंट्स ओवर हियर टुडे, क्लास 11 साइंस केमिस्ट्री. नाउ टुडे इन दिस क्लास वीडियो लेसन 8 टुडे आई विल बी कंटिन्यूइंग विद द चैप्टर ऑर्गेनिक केमिस्ट्री एंड आई विल बी ट्राइंग टू कंप्लीट डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ केमिकल रिएक्शंस एंड देयर मैकेनिज्म्स. टू बिगिन विद माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, फर्स्ट आई वुड लाइक टू बिगिन विद टाइप्स ऑफ अटैकिंग रिएजेंट्स. ओके, वीडियो लेसन 8. सो now look at the heading over here, types of attacking reagents, video lesson 8. Now what are attacking reagents? First, that is important, what are attacking reagents? Okay, now attacking reagents, the species which attack on a substrate molecule and bring about a chemical change are called attacking reagents. Now the attacking reagents common in organic reactants may be classified into two categories. There are two categories of attacking reagents. The first one, it is called over here electrophilic. It is called electrophilic, PHILIC, electrophilic reagents. And the other one is called nucleophilic reagents. Nucleophilic reagents. Okay, electrophilic, nucleophilic. Now going in detail regarding the electrophilic and nucleophilic reagents. Now this electrophilic reagents means electron loving. No? Electrophilic reagent means what? Electron loving. Look at nucleophilic reagents. Nucleophilic means nucleus loving. Nucleus loving. Now, again, what do you mean by electron loving and nucleus loving? Now, when I say electron loving, they have an affinity for electrons. These reagents over here, electrophilic reagents, they possess a deficiency of electrons, and therefore in chemical reaction they attack on those centers which are rich in electrons. So here again, remember, electrophilic reagents, they are deficient in electrons, they are devoid of electrons, that is why they attack on those centers which are rich in electrons. So remember, they attack those centers rich in electrons, which means these electrophilic reagents can be either positively charged or they may be neutral. So we'll come to this in detail after some time. Looking at the other side over here, the nucleophilic reagents, nucleus loving, as I've already told you. Now these nucleophilic reagents are electron rich. They are what? Electron rich species and possess at least one lone pair of electrons. They are what? Electron rich. Having at least one pair of electrons. Therefore, if you go to the chemical reactions, these nucleophilic reagents attack those centers. They attack those centers which are deficient in electrons. So that is a very important thing to understand over here. So I hope you're getting some idea very clear over here. Electrophilic reagents, electron loving. Nucleophilic reagents, nucleus loving. Electrophilic reagents, they are what? They are deficient in electron, you can say. They are what you call? Now they have an affinity for electrons, they have a deficiency of electrons. Okay, that is why they attack those centers which are rich in electrons. They may be positive and neutral. either positive or neutral. We'll come to the examples after some time. Now, looking at the nucleophilic reagents, nucleophilic, the word nucleus loving. Nucleus is positive, so nucleophilic reagents, they can be what? They have to be rich in electrons, carrying a negative charge, and that is why they have to attack those centers which are deficient in electrons. Okay. Now, let us go in detail first about the different types of electrophilic reagents. Okay. Now, regarding the different types of electrophilic reagents, electrophilic reagents are of two types. Remember, how many are there? They are of two types of electrophilic reagents. The first one, it is called positively charged electrophiles. Okay. Now, as soon as I talk about positively charged electrophiles, okay, so we get the idea that they're going to attack electron-rich centers. Examples are more important over here because that will help us understand and memorize and remember the examples. So, examples, you may note it down: H plus, H3O plus, NO plus, NO2 plus, Cl plus, Br plus, I plus, C6H5N2 plus, okay, diazonium, this one is a diazonium ion, then RCH2 plus, this is a 1 degree carbocation, then we have R2CH plus, this is a 2 degree carbocation, then we have R3C plus, it is a 3 degree carbocation, okay, and so on. So these are the examples of positively charged electrophiles. Okay. Now, moving on to the neutral electrophiles. The neutral electrophiles, the second one, under electrophiles, neutral electrophiles. Now, as I've already told you, neutral electrophiles, some neutral species over here possess a deficiency of electrons, act as neutral electrophiles. Okay. Now, here there are some species, you know, there are some species like boron trifluoride, BF3, aluminium chloride, in which the central atom has only 6 electrons. So, let me, you know, clear these examples over here. Boron trifluoride. Boron trifluoride. One example. Another one is aluminium trichloride, aluminium chloride, AlCl3. Okay. These are two examples of neutral electrophiles which have, you know, only 6 electrons. The central atom has only how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 6 electrons. 6 electrons. Okay. Now, this having 6 electrons make them deficient of electrons. That is why they are going to attack the what you call centers which are rich in electrons. The other one is under neutral electrophile is free radicals, carbenes and nitrines. Now, free radicals like methyl free radical, CH3 dot, methyl free radical. Another one is methylene carbene, CH2, two electrons on this carbon. Okay. Another one is dichlorocarbene, CCl2, this carbon, two electrons. Another one is nitrine, you know, that is nitrine, that is a very nice example. Nitrine, COO, C2H5, this one is called nitrine. So, here are some, these are some examples of neutral electrophiles, you know, where the central atom, in this case, the central atom, it is what? It is what? Short of electron. It has only 6 electrons. Now, in the case of free radicals, which are acting as neutral electrophiles over here, it is to be noted that each free radical is short of one electron. the free radical is short of one electron. Whereas the carbenes over here, the carbenes which you can see, these are the two carbenes, and nitrogens are short of a pair of electrons. Okay. Now, thus positively charged and neutral electrophiles are short of a pair of electrons. This is why they have a strong tendency to attack at electron-rich centers and behave as Lewis acids. Okay. So, what is Lewis acids? What is Lewis acid? That is more important to understand over here. So, you may note this sentence. This is why the electrophiles have a strong tendency to attack at electron-rich centers and thus behave as Lewis acids, a very important term which has been coined over here. Okay, so whenever Lewis acids come to your mind, think about whom? Think about electrophiles. They are capable of attacking what? Electron-rich centers. So, electrophiles, electron-loving, they are themselves deficient in electrons, or maybe neutral, short of one electron or short of two electrons. Okay, that is why whenever this word Lewis acid comes to your mind, think about electrophiles. They are correlated. Okay, so that was the explanation for electrophilic reagents or electrophiles. Now, let us move further to the second topic over here. Now, that is second topic, that is number B, nucleophilic reagents or nucleophiles. Now, the word nucleophilic, as I've already told you, nucleus loving, which means this electrophile, this attacking agent, it must be carrying what? Some charge, you know. It must be carrying some charge because it has electrons, extra electrons. So, anything which is nucleus loving, you know, it must be negative in charge. Okay, so that I've already told you. Now, the nucleophiles are electron-rich species. So, nucleophiles are what? These are electron-rich species. And possess at least one lone pair of electrons. Therefore, in non-chemical reaction, they attack those centers which are deficient in electrons. Okay. Now, going to the different types of, you know, two types of nucleophilic reagents. One we have negatively. The first one is negatively charged. Negatively charged nucleophiles. The other one is what? Neutral nucleophiles. So, these are the two important types of nucleophilic reagents. One is negatively charged and other one is neutral. Now, neutral is possible in electrophile also. It is possible in nucleophile also. But nucleophiles, they are negatively charged. Whereas electrophiles, I told you, they are what? They are positively charged. Electrophiles are what? Positively charged. You can see over here. Okay. Now, moving to the examples of negatively charged over here, nucleophiles. negatively charged, negatively charged, charged nucleophiles, nucleophiles. Now the examples are, you know, OH minus hydroxy, OR, CN minus, then H, you can say hydride, CH minus, Cl minus, Br minus, I minus, RCH2 minus, okay, R2CH minus, R3C minus, RCO minus, etc. Okay, so these are some examples of negatively charged nucleophiles carrying a negative charge, of course. No? Now, in these species, in all these species, they possess an electron pair along with a negative charge. Okay, that is very, very important to understand over here. The other one over here is neutral. Neutral nucleophiles. Neutral nucleophiles, which are not carrying any charge. Examples I can talk about, you know, like first example I can talk about is water. H2O, no charge. But the central atom is having two lone pair of electrons. Similarly, alcohols, ROH. Then we can have ethers, ROR, ethers. Okay, are you getting it? Then we can have, we can talk about ammonia, NH3. Okay, neutral nucleophiles. It will attack what? It will attack electron, what you call, positive center. It will attack the nucleus, you know. Okay. Then we can talk about amines, RNH2. The nucleophile will attack the nucleus, which are positive centers. Okay. So these are some examples of, you know, negatively charged nucleophiles and neutral nucleophiles. Now, here, when I was talking about electrophiles, I told you that they are acting as Lewis acids. They are acting as Lewis acid. Acceptor, you know, Lewis acid, acceptor, electron pair acceptor, electron acceptor. Now, here you keep in mind that nucleophiles, they behave as Lewis, they behave as Lewis bases. Okay, so note that both negatively and neutral electrophiles possess lone pair of electrons and can donate it to an electron deficient species. They can donate electron to an electron deficient species. That is why they are bases. When I talk about acids, they can accept electrons. Accept a pair of electrons maybe. That is why Lewis acid. LA. Electron pair acceptor. Lewis base. Electron pair donor. Okay. And then they behave as Lewis acids and attack the substrate molecule at the site of lowest electron density. So wherever there is a site of lowest electron density, that becomes a positive charge center. Okay. So this was all about, my dear students, this was all about the attacking reagents in organic chemistry. Okay. Electrophiles and nucleophiles in very, very detail, very much detail. Okay. You don't have to go anything beyond this. Now, going to the next part of this chapter, let me start the next part of the chapter, types of organic reactions and their mechanisms. Types of organic reactions and their mechanisms. So under these types of organic reactions and the mechanisms, the broad classification has been done in the following categories. The first type of organic reaction, it is called substitution reaction. It is called substitution reaction. It is called substitution reaction. Okay, first one. Then we have got addition reaction. Addition reaction. Then we have number 3, elimination reaction. एलिमिनेशन रिएक्शन, एलिमिनेशन रिएक्शन, देन वी हैव रीअरेंजमेंट रिएक्शन, रीअरेंजमेंट रिएक्शन. ओके, नाउ सब्स्टिट्यूशन रिएक्शन, एडिशन रिएक्शंस, इन क्लास 10 यू हैव कम अक्रॉस ऑल दिस. But elimination reaction, rearrangement reaction is something which you will be learning here specifically in much detail, because this will help us later on in understanding, you know, understanding the mechanisms in organic chemistry when you go to class 12. Okay, so there is one more reaction, one or two more reactions which can be discussed in this chapter, that is number 5. I can talk about condensation reactions also. Condensation reactions. Number 6 can be, it is isomerization. Isomerization reactions. Okay. So, these are the types of organic reactions which should be discussed along with the mechanisms. Okay. Now, moving to the first type of organic reaction. The first type of organic reaction, as you can see over here, it is substitution. Substitution reaction. Now, when I say substitution reaction, what does it mean? Now, these reactions which involve the direct replacement of an atom or a group of atoms by some other atom or a group of atoms are referred to as substitution reactions. Now, this you will understand if I do few examples. Now, it depends upon the nature of the attacking reagent. Okay, so under this category, we have the first category, that is nucleophilic substitution reaction. Nucleophilic substitution. Reaction. A substitution reaction by a nucleophile, it is called nucleophilic substitution reaction. Now, the substitution reactions which are brought about by the attack of a nucleophile, they are termed as nucleophilic substitution reaction and are represented by SN. So, here you remember SN. N. This is nucleophilic substitution reaction. Representation is SN. So one brief general example I can give over here. Say we have an alkyl halide. R is alkyl group. X is a halogen. So this alkyl halide, it is acting as the substrate. It is not the attacking agent. Now, I bring a nucleophile, you know, nucleophile examples, you have already seen that, see, you already seen so many examples of that, nucleophile negatively charged or maybe neutral, okay. So, now I'll bring a nucleophile like a hydroxide ion, OH minus ion. It is a stronger nucleophile. So, what happens over here? This OH is going to replace the direct replacement of the halogen. So what happens? It forms ROH plus X minus. The halide ion is out. So this one is a nucleophile. This is a nucleophile. It is a strong nucleophile. Okay. So that was a general reaction, but not the mechanism of nucleophilic substitution reaction. Now we go to the most important part of this organic reactions and the mechanisms. Keep in mind, nucleophilic substitution reactions are of two types. Nucleophilic substitution reactions are of basically two types. One is called SN1. The other one is SN2. When I say SN1, I mean substitution nucleophilic unimolecular. Substitution nucleophilic unimolecular, unimolecular. When I say SN2, it is substitution nucleophilic bimolecular. So these are very important terms in organic reactions and the mechanism. Now we are doing the first type, that is substitution reactions. So whenever substitution reactions come to your mind, think about SN1, SN2. I have explained you just now only the meaning of SN1, only the abbreviation. Substitution nucleophilic unimolecular. Uni means one. Okay, substitution by a nucleophile. Unimolecular, one molecule is involved over here. Now why it is unimolecular? So please keep in mind, in SN1 reactions, the rate of a reaction is dependent only upon the concentration of the substrate. Now what is the rate determining step? The slowest step in any chemical reaction, it is called the rate determining step. So if the rate is dependent only on the concentration of one of the species, then it is called unimolecular. So substitution by a nucleophile happening where the rate of the reaction is dependent only on the substrate, concentration of the substrate, then it becomes substitution nucleophilic unimolecular reaction. So such reactions, they are called SN1 reaction. Now looking at the SN2 reaction, substitution nucleophilic bimolecular reaction, here please keep in mind the rate of the reaction, it is dependent upon the concentration of the substrate as well as the nucleophile, which is the attacking region. So that is a very, very nice difference over here to be kept in mind. Okay, so now the picture is must be very clear to all of you. Substitution nucleophilic unimolecular, why? Because the rate of the reaction, it is dependent only on the concentration of the substrate. This square bracket which you see in chemistry, it signifies concentration. So here the rate is dependent only on the concentration of the substrate, the strength, the amount of substrate taken. Whereas in substitution nucleophilic bimolecular reactions, the rate is dependent upon the concentration of the substrate as well as the concentration of the nucleophile. So that is a very important difference between SN1 and SN2 reactions. Now, most importantly, my dear students, now let me explain you SN1 reaction with the help of an example in detail. Okay, now moving to the next slide. SN1 reaction example. So this should make the picture very clear in your mind. Okay, let us see. Now let me tell you that in SN1 reactions, please keep in mind, all tertiary alkyl halides, they undergo substitution by SN1 mechanism. They undergo substitution by what? SN1 mechanism. So I will straightforward move to the mechanism over here. First, I will give you the, single step reaction. Then I will explain you the mechanism. Okay. First, I will show you the reaction. Okay. Reaction is given below. So I'm taking CH3Br. Okay. So you have this compound, tertiary butyl bromide. It is Br. Okay. Tertiary butyl bromide. If you bring the nucleophile, OH minus from where? Either using potassium hydroxide or sodium hydroxide, whatever. Okay, so what happens over here? This OH minus is going to directly replace the Br. Directly going to replace the Br. So it forms CH3, 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 and over here OH plus Br minus. Okay, so this is the reaction happening. Now I will explain you the mechanism. Very, very important step. Mechanism. Mechanism of SN1 reaction. Mechanism of SN1 reaction. Okay. Now let us have a look at the mechanism. CH3, 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 and then there is Br, tertiary butyl bromide, 3 degree alkyl halide. Okay. Now, the first step. In the first step, what happens? Ionization happens. Ionization takes place. Formation of ions from this alkyl halide takes place, where in the first step, a cation is formed, carbocation, because the bromide is leaving, you know. This is step one. This is step one, and this step one is a slow step. It is a slow step, and every slow step in a chemical reaction becomes the rate determining step. Keep that in mind. Every slow step in a reaction mechanism is the rate determining step. So here in this first step of the reaction, you see the rate of the reaction is dependent only upon the concentration of the substrate. So that is why it is called SN1 reaction. Though the reaction happens in more than one steps, but the rate determining step is dependent only upon the concentration of the substrate. That is why we call it SN1. Now, in the second step, my dear students, where CH3 plus sign, the carbocation. Now the nucleophile comes into play and it is going to attack the carbon rich center over here. Okay. And then you're going to get the tertiary butyl alcohol. Tertiary butyl alcohol like this. CH3. Okay. Now this is step two, and it is a fast step. It is a what? Fast step. Step two, and it is a fast step. Okay, so this is how SN1 mechanism has been explained. Now to summarize, I want to just summarize quickly over here. SN1 reaction, which is called substitution nucleophilic unimolecular reaction, because the rate of the reaction is dependent only on the concentration of the substrate. Okay. And I have given one example, general example over here. Tertiary butyl bromide being attacked by a nucleophile OH minus, it is forming tertiary butyl alcohol and Br is leaving. The mechanism part, SN1 reactions, they happen in two steps. SN1 reactions, they happen in two steps. The first step is the ionization. The first step is a slow step, and every slow step, it is a rate determining step of the reaction. That is why that time you have seen the rate is dependent only on the concentration of the substrate. Okay, what is a substrate? A substrate is the reagent which is used, okay, in organic reactions. Okay, so that was the mechanism of SN1 reactions. Now little bit about the stereochemistry of SN1 reaction. Stereochemistry of SN1 reactions. Let me explain this quickly. Okay. Now you have learned just now that SN1 reactions, you know, they happen in two steps, and the slowest step is the rate determining step. You have already seen. Now let me come to one example over here. Now, if you bring an alkyl halide, you know, the alkyl halide, you see, I will just do an example over here. The halogen, let's say HCRR, this can be R1, this can be R2, and then the halogen over here. Okay. The ionization is happening in the first step. So, when the ion is formed, you know, this formation of ion is so important, you know. It forms H, R1, R2, okay, and the positive charges over here. Okay. Now, this carbon, which is carrying a positive charge, it can be attacked from front side or back side, both the sides, you know. Attack from front side, if it is front side, if I take this to be front side and this to be back side, so it depends now. If it is being attacked from the front side, if the OH minus is attacking from the front side, from towards you, and this is from the other side, okay. So if it is being attacked from the front side, then you get what? You get the structure of the resultant alcohol like this, R1, H, and this is R2. It is an enantiomer. Okay. If it is being attacked from the back side, then we'll get something like this. OH, C, X, not X over here. This is H, sorry. H, and there is R1, and then there is R2. Okay. These two are what? These two are enantiomers. These two are what? Enantiomers. This carbon is optically active. Optically active means these groups, all of them are different from each other, making it optically active. So here, please keep in mind, if the alkyl halide is optically active, a 1:1 mixture of the two enantiomers should be obtained. Hence, the product should be a recipe mixture. Okay, so here, that is all about the stereochemistry of SN1 reaction. Okay, so possibility of attack is from the front side over here, from the back side. If it is attacked from the front side, then OH comes here. The H goes this side, R goes up, and R2 comes down. Okay, so that is how you have to understand the stereochemistry of SN1 reactions. Now, moving to the SN2 reactions. Okay, now SN1 is over. Let us go to the SN2 reactions. Okay, now that is number 2. SN2 reactions. I have already told you, SN2 reaction, the abbreviation, substitution nucleophilic bimolecular. SN1 you have seen, it is unimolecular, but the reaction is happening in two steps. But here, SN2 reaction, it is bimolecular, and the reaction will happen in a single step over here. I have already told you that time only, that the rate of the such reaction, SN2 reaction, is dependent on the concentration of substrate as well as the nucleophile. Okay, so looking at this concept over here, let me show one mechanism at the same time. Now keep in mind, SN2 reactions, you know, they are shown by, you know, 1-degree alkyl halides, primary alkyl halides, okay, primary. So that is why if I give you an example like this, one example, this is methyl bromide. This compound is what? It is methyl bromide and it is the substrate. So if I bring a nucleophile, OH minus, the hydroxyl ion, the attacking nucleophile, then it is only one step. Here you get a transition state. The OH is attacking. The Br minus is leaving. The OH is carrying a negative charge. The Br minus is also carrying a negative charge. It is leaving. And then we have this three hydrogens. So this stage which you see, this is called a transition state. It is not a final product. Now immediately the Br leaves, goes out, this is coming in, OH minus is coming in. So I get wicket HOCHHH plus BR minus. So this compound is methanol. It is the product, substitution product. This compound is methanol. Now you have seen over here, the OH is attacking from the, it is attacking from the other side. It cannot attack from the group which is going to leave. That is why normally in SN2 reaction there is inversion in configuration. Like just now the umbrella is like this. Umbrella is what? Umbrella like this. Umbrella. So when it is going that side, umbrella is becoming the other side. It is becoming like this. Okay, so that is how there is inversion in configuration. Now looking at the stereochemistry of SN2 reaction, I hope till here you are clear. SN2 reactions occur in single step. SN2 reactions are undergone by mainly 1 degree alkyl halides. Okay, they occur in single step. This single step is the only rate determining step in this reaction, where there is an involvement of both the substrate as well as the nucleophile in this step. Okay. Now keep in mind, SN2 reaction is always followed by inversion in configuration. That is, there is inversion in configuration, which I've already told you. In the beginning, the structure is like this. When the nucleophile is attacked, the structure has become the other side, like this. You know? So that is called inversion in configuration. Now I would like to give you one example for this SN2 reaction. One example. If I take a carboxylic acid, carboxylic acid like this, with a formula like this, CH2COH, look at this. This carboxylic acid, this carbon atom is optically active because this group, and this group all are different. Okay. Now this acid, it is called dextrochlorosuccinic acid. SUCCINIC, succinic acid, dextrochlorosuccinic acid, okay, plus sign, because it will rotate the plane of chloride right in the clockwise direction. Okay, so now if this is reacted with a nucleophile OH minus, this is the leaving group. So OH minus is not going to attack from here, it is not going to attack from here, it is going to attack from the other side, from this side. That is why the product which is formed will have a structure like this. HO, that is OH, hydrogen is pushed that side, other side, and then COH remains as it is, and here CH2COH becomes like this. So here this compound which is formed, it is called levomalic acid. I will suggest you all to remember this name and this reaction, because this is going to help you in your competitive examinations. How will you convert this fellow over here to this fellow? Dechlorosuccinic acid, optically active. This is also optically active, my dear students. So conversion of dechlorosuccinic acid to L-malic acid. Levo means negative charge. So this compound is going to rotate the plane of chloride in the anticlockwise direction. Now we have seen over here, therefore SN2 reactions, they follow by the inversion in configuration. The Cl was here, but the incoming group is on the other side, so that is called inversion. It is called inversion in configuration. And this inversion in configuration, my dear students, it is also called Walden inversion. It is also called Walden inversion. Okay. Now, here I have already told you all primary alkyl halides undergo substitution by SN2 mechanism. The secondary alkyl halides undergo both SN1 and SN2 mechanism depending upon the experimental conditions. Okay. Now, my dear students, the second type of chemical reactions whose mechanisms which need to study, it is called electrophilic substitution electrophilic substitution reactions, and these electrophilic substitution reactions I will do in my next class. Okay, please go through this part of this chapter properly. Thank you.